So then, on a few days, on a Saturday afternoon, we eat in the restaurant. Westmost corner of Weston. And some of you got lost, I'm sure, but somehow made it. I appreciate that very much. My name is Kamala Anandam, for those who do not know me. I'm the president of the Western branch of American Association of University Women. We call AAUW Weston. I want to recognize some few people. Toby Boyer just came in. She is the commissioner of City of Weston. And Patty Lynn just arrived. We also formed a trade agreement. I don't know that AAUW Weston board members, Margaret is here. And Eileen is at the table, right?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. Joe is not here, Carolina Yamehouse. I want to recognize Virginia Velas. I hope I said your last name correct.
I'll take any of them.
I do with my last name too. She is the co-president of the AAW Florida for the state. And I'm so glad you're here. Thank you. Two more board members just arrived. Elaine is there, and Annette just arrived. Thank you. I want to recognize the newest members. Bonnie, are you here? Bonnie, there is something for you.
Oh, thank you very much.
She just joined us in December, and together. Broward chapter of UNA USA, represented by Eileen. Broward Sheriff's Office and Western YMCA, Natalie, who have been very helpful, and John also, they are both here. Thank you very much. I want to thank the speakers, Representative Stark. I know your time is very busy, you have too many engagements, but you care to take the time to come and speak to us and kick off this event. I'm very thankful to you. We have you have this handout with you, which gives the bio of all the speakers, so we don't have to introduce each of them, take time, because I want you to hear from them about the work they do. So we have with us Barbara Martinez, Assistant United States Attorney. And we have Detective Lorraine. I don't know how to pronounce your last name. People have difficulty with my name too. And Detective Nicholas Masters, thank you. Adrian Reese, where are you? You are in the back. Sally is here?
Karen Fine.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Sally Brentswick, Terry, then Joseph. She's in the back. Ron Osler from Women in Distress. And Lily Gallardo from Salvation Army, right? And you are so fortunate, and I am very fortunate to have these speakers. They work in the field, either investigating, advocating, prosecuting, and helping the victims. And one particular program is preventing somebody, girls, from becoming victims. So I'm very proud that all of you agreed to come, and you are in for a treat. I'm going to say a thing because I represent AAUW Weston. You have a unique opportunity to join us for less dues because it's half a year plus you came here. So people at the AAUW table in the back would have your application form if you want to join us. It's going to cost you only $38.25 for the rest of the year. A few words about your handouts so you don't miss them. You have the program, you would have seen it. We are just going to follow one after the other. I already mentioned to you about the bios of the speakers. And this is a quick fact that is put out by my national association, AAUW, quick facts about human trafficking. And the last one, this was our particular attention this year, is to give you suggestions as to how you can help. So you won't go empty-handed. There's something, we did something here and there that you can do. So those are the handouts. And I think I probably mentioned everybody. The planning committee members, like Shelley Shermack will join us. She's a member of Weston. Dr. Eileen Davis, Jerome, and UNA USA Broward chapter helped us. Natalie from YMCA, Patty Lynn, and Rebecca Nicholson. Rebecca, are you here? You see. Okay. And Adrian Reese also helps with the planning committee. I think you have heard from me for the rest of the day. And so we would start with kickoff. Oh, no, sorry, not kickoff yet. I didn't even want to greet the laundry. They have made the first mistake.
You want me to come down? Will do. I'm honored. Stay right here. Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and I want to again congratulate after Dr. Nani does all of those who participated and made this happen, and I want to congratulate those of you that found the time to come today for this. AAUW is a fantastic organization. It's a member of the United Nations Association of the United States of America. AAUW serves as an NGO for the Broward County chapter of UNA USA, and I can't thank you enough for doing this very fantastic workshop and making sure that we're getting the information out to those who care and can really be in a position to help. Outside, the United Nations Association has also left you some leaflets, one from the U.S. Department of State, for whom we work with as well, 20 Ways to Stop Human Trafficking. You have information about our educational programs for children and adults to get involved with United Nations Association, and also membership information. I just, before I sit down, want to be sure to make a presentation to really help us kick this off. And it is a citation that's being presented to our NGO, AAUW, American Association of University Women, Weston Branch, Dr. Kamala Anandan, President, for organizing and presenting the public event, Stop Human Trafficking, learn about the multi-billion dollar industry, meet the people who help prevent the problem or help the victims, find out how you can help. And they are being awarded this because we commend AAUW for organizing this entire program for your promotion of the United Nations campaign to eliminate the recruitment, transportation, transfer, harboring, or receipt of persons by means of the threat or use of force or other forms of coercion, of abduction, of fraud, of deception, of the abuse of power, or of a position of vulnerability, of the giving or receiving of payments or benefits to achieve the consent of a person having control over another person for the purpose of exploitation. Exploitation shall include, at a minimum, the exploitation of the prostitution of others or other forms of sexual exploitation forced labor or services, slavery, or practices similar to slavery, servitude, or the removal of organs. That's what UNAUSA supports, and AAUW has helped in getting that word out. So we thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
But on behalf of the YMCA of Weston, just want to welcome you all to our facility. If you haven't been in the Y before, please do take the time to stop by the front desk. We can show you if you're around. We are more than just a gym. That's why I was so honored to have this event here today in our facility. We offer a variety of youth and youth programs, adult programs, even active older adult programming. So for those of you that are a part of this group, please keep the Y in mind and how we can help you do your work in the community. So thanks again.
You all hear me well. I normally, if it wasn't Kamala, I wouldn't be here today. I am not feeling good, and I even have my wife drive me here. But I even at the very last minute, even up to, like, say, 20 minutes before I got here, I was doing more research on the internet about human trafficking. And I'm sure that we're going to hear some of the same definitions over and over again. You know, very often you hear about human trafficking in, you know, you see an article in the newspaper, you hear this about it, but evidently this is going on all the time, pretty much under the radar for most of us in average daily life. But according to some articles I read on the internet, this is still probably the fastest growing crime worldwide, not just necessarily in the United States. In Florida, we are now the third most populous state, we just passed New York, and we are also third in the nation for human trafficking as well. Now, the state of Florida has done a number of things in the last 10 years or so regarding human trafficking. I spoke to somebody earlier here, said, you know, you're a little slow in doing this, and I agree. Sometimes we, even in the legislature, complain that, you know, Florida could move a little bit quicker, but there have been a lot of things done in the past 10 years. And I'm just going to give you an idea of a few of those. Number one, in 2004, human trafficking was labeled as a first-degree felony, punishable by up to 30 years in prison. In 2006, there were changes in the law that added wording that said, threatening to destroy or to destroy immigration documents for the purpose of forced employment was a felony. So these are just, you know, little baby steps. You fast forward to 2010, not in the state of Florida, but in the state of Illinois, in 2010, passed something called the Saving Children's Act. Now, this decriminalizes forced prostitution of minors from criminal, in other words, it won't be criminal prosecution, but children would be placed in the child welfare system. And in 2013, Florida followed suit. And this puts DCF with the Department of Juvenile Justice and with law enforcement agencies to work together. And that was part of the 2013 bill. In 2012, I know I'm going backwards a little bit, but I'm just going to read you part of the statute. And if you look on the books, you can write it down. It's statute 787.06. That's a Florida statute. And it says, Florida's human trafficking statute, and it defines human trafficking as the transporting, soliciting, recruiting, harboring, providing, enticing, maintaining, or obtaining another person for the purpose of exploitation of a person. The statute contains a variety of provisions prohibiting persons from knowingly engaging in human trafficking and using coercion for labor or services. Now, we generally think of human trafficking as prostitution of women. Generally, it is not adult women. Very often, it is under age 18 women. And I saw on the internet the boys. And I kept right here in the summary from the Florida House of Representatives, it says the average age at which girls first become victims of prostitution is 12 to 14. For boys and transgender youth, it's 11 to 13. So you've got a really terrible thing that's going on that people would want to profit from using people for a modern day slavery, for basically forced labor where they don't get paid, or they promise to be paid and they're not paid. And these are just a few of the things that are going on. Now, I'm going to end with this just to tell you where we are, the latest in the state of Florida. Last year, 2014, and this goes, and I'm going to read you just about the part from the Florida House of Representatives. but by a vote of 118-0 in the Florida House of Representatives, we passed Bill 7141. It was later amended by the Senate. Really, it was pretty much the same when it emerged, and it was signed by the governor. And basically, what this was, this bill was in response to some of the things you saw in the newspaper last year about people in the child welfare system, or people who were just total strangers that were, you know, victims of abuse that they didn't feel that DCF was handling properly. So basically, it says the bill amends statutes regarding sexual exploitation of a child, which includes encouraging, forcing, I mean, I don't want to read the same information that we have. But the bill changes administrative requirements for DCF and the community-based care agencies related to sexually exploited children. It requires DCF to create or adopt initial screening and assessment instruments to identify and serve sexually exploited children. Now, I'm not giving you the entire nature of this bill. It can be found on the internet. If you want to know more about it, I'm happy to have my staff send you the whole law, or what the bill summary was last year. But the bill also created a certification program for safe houses and safe foster homes at the Department of Children and Families, and requires certification in order for these facilities to accept state funds specifically allocated for the care of sexually exploited children. The bill also created something called the Statewide Council on Human Trafficking within the Department of Legal Affairs to enhance and develop and coordination of law enforcement and social services responses. And lastly, the bill also addresses Florida's child welfare system. It specifies that DCF, CBCs, and CBC subcontractors share responsibility for child welfare outcome goals, and requires the DCF to contract with a qualified organization to prepare a plan for results-oriented accountability program. So there is a statewide effort to really work in this direction more than there has been in many years. So anyway, listen, thank you for putting me in the kickoff position. I was thinking maybe like baseball, like the leadoff position. Wasn't sure exactly what that meant. But thank you, Alan, for me to speak here. And, you know, you really do put together, you know, great events for the community, and I really thank you for that.
For being here on a Saturday afternoon. As you've heard, my name is Barbara Martinez and I'm a federal prosecutor. I have 15 minutes today to tell you about human trafficking. I have my phone here because I need to watch some time. You know that lawyers can talk. And I don't want to keep you here all afternoon. But can I see a show of hands? How many of you, and I see a lot of familiar faces and I know a lot of you, but how many of you have actually worked with human trafficking victims or in some sort of human trafficking campaign other than today? Can I see a show of hands? Okay. So many of you, but definitely not all of you, and maybe half, if that. So I guess in the next 15 minutes, I want to tell you what human trafficking is in not a legal way, because I find that the legal definitions are very easy to look up, and you probably have them in your pamphlets, and they don't necessarily mean anything, especially when I have detectives and law enforcement officers that are calling me and asking me, is this human trafficking? I suggest to you that maybe it's not as simple as just reading something. The second thing is to emphasize to you through case examples, just briefly, some of the different types of schemes, specifically sex trafficking schemes involving women and children in South Florida. Sadly, I have become aware of the fact that we do have this problem in this area more than in many other areas in the country, because I have met with many of these victims, and our prosecution teams throughout the district have done great work to try to prosecute these people, the targets. And finally, how, just briefly, to stop human trafficking. So I guess, what is human trafficking? It is modern day slavery. Human Trafficking Awareness Month this month, it's great that everyone understands that this is about freedom for our women, for our children, here in the United States and everywhere, globally. But I am here here to tell you that there are countless survivors of this heinous crime here, and that the exploitation of people for commercial sex acts is absolutely one of our biggest priorities. It is wonderful to see that in the last 10 years, many more people are understanding about this. Now, the 2014 Trafficking in Persons Report, which is issued by the State Department, estimates that 44,000 survivors of trafficking were identified in the past year alone. The report, that's not my report, right? Just in case. The report also estimates that more than 20 million victims of trafficking have not been identified.
Wow.
In South Florida alone, we have identified traffickers who prey on potential victims from almost every continent, and mostly from right here in South Florida. The Caribbean, Mexico, South America, and yes, here in South Florida, including, by the way, Weston. We do have a pending case involving a target from Weston now that's public, although not highly public yet. And then we do have had other cases involving defendants who have engaged in travel to engage in sexual acts, more of a sex tourism type case, but still targets from Weston. So because of this widespread problem, we know that we have federal laws and state laws to address them. The federal law is the Trafficking Victim Protection Act, or the TVPA. This criminalizes the sexual exploitation and specifically exploiting someone through the use of coercion, force, or fraud for the purpose of a commercial sex act, whether they are adults or whether they are minors. And if they are minors, force, fraud, and coercion do not need to be used. Bottom line, if you are under 18 and you are being prostituted by a pimp, you're in violation of a federal criminal law and you're facing at least a 10-year, potentially a 15-year mandatory minimum. Whether or not the minor is technically agreeing to do it or not. So, I want to tell you that the first victim that I encountered was in about, that I personally worked with, who was a foreign victim, was 14 years old. And this happened when she had been brought down to Homestead. There was a prostitution rape in Homestead, and she was found in a bedroom, and all of this was made public, was found in a bedroom. She had been servicing 20 to 30 migrant workers a day.
Oh, wow.
In a one-bedroom apartment, and there were men lined up who would walk up or ride in their bikes outside the door. And it was only because she was a minor that this was that I was contacted, or our office was contacted. And we found that there were in fact adult victims as well, not just minor victims in that case. I'm happy to report that victim is a survivor and that she's doing very well, and she's living in the United States, not in South Florida, and that those traffickers were successfully prosecuted and are still serving time and were serving lengthy sentences. It was the beginning for me of an understanding of what human trafficking is about. And it is about the person who is victimized. It is about the exploitation of people. Since then, I've realized that every victim's exploitation is different, and the schemes used by traffickers to exploit their victims vary. It can be extremely difficult to detect this crime. In fact, I often receive calls about is this human trafficking, and I say to people, I think there are three essential elements for human trafficking, and that's vulnerable victims, exploitation, and what really makes it human trafficking as opposed to any other type of sex crime is labor or commercial sex acts, okay? So you have to have that commercial sex, somebody profiting in some way or another. It's not always prostitution, by the way. Sadly, people find a lot of different ways to profit, selling their children, for example, for prostitution, videotaping sexual acts and selling those, that can also count as commercial sexual acts. So victims of human trafficking, we all understand, may be vulnerable for many reasons. But I feel the need to really highlight that for you, because I think that there is always a stereotype in people's minds about the type of women or the type of children or the type of girls or boys that get into the situation. I am going to tell you from experience, not from any other perspective, just that I have seen children who come from good homes. I have seen children who are poor, children who are wealthy, children who are runaways, women who were strong, you know, at one point, teachers, former teachers, women who were not always the strongest and had drug issues or had other problems, were sexually abused themselves, boys, men who struggled with their identity, sexual identity. It is very different for each person. And so the way that you figure out the vulnerability in a particular trafficking matter is to really get to know that victim and understand the circumstances and understand why it is that this person is in this position. This does not happen overnight. It is not easy to do, and it is not something that somebody who is a community member can always easily identify. So, to further illustrate the point that there are different types of trafficking schemes, I want to give you another example. So, in October of 2014, following a two-week trial, Damien Bastone was sentenced to 27 years for sex trafficking, money laundering, and other related charges. Now, the evidence in this case showed that this man was a Jamaican national who was using a fake identity. He was running essentially an escort service at one point, but he would meet women, and he was a good-looking, intelligent guy who got them to be his girlfriend. His first victim was a very well-educated Australian woman who was actually in a supervisory position, and she testified, so this is all public information. Now, over the years, this man physically abused, beat, tortured, raped at least seven women who testified at trial and other women that I'm sure we don't know of. He traveled all over the world using this fake identity. Interestingly, and I know some of you have heard me say this before, the thing I find amazing is that he was rarely stopped. The women who were traveling overseas, they were stopped repeatedly. Which was helpful, by the way, in making our case later. Now, the important thing about this that I want to share is that although victims of human trafficking are often transported, and I've mentioned to you a case involving foreigners, although, by the way, in the Boston case, there were also victims who were from the United States, all adults, by the way, all adult females. Transportation is not required. This is not a crime about transportation. It is a crime about exploitation, okay? So, unfortunately, use of the term trafficking often leads people to assume that movement or transportation of victims is required. It is so important. If you're here, if you know nothing else when you leave today, it's that transportation is not required for human trafficking, and it is not required for federal human trafficking. We at the U.S. Attorney's Office do not just prosecute cases involving foreigners. We prosecute single victim cases of United States citizens all the time. Why? Because this is about exploitation and taking away somebody's freedom. That is why we're here on Human Trafficking Awareness Month. That is why we talk about slavery. This is not illegal alien, it's not smuggling. So, I don't have much more time, but I want to talk to you about the sex trafficking of minors and then what we can do to help. I can't possibly go through, sadly, the number of, or give you case examples in the time frame that I'm allotted. We have too many, and that is a sad state of events here in South Florida. We often talk about a case, you know, that had seven or eight victims, I think, that you worked on early on. And I think the first case when we were talking about Mosey was 2012. We had many other sex trafficking of minors cases, but this case had so many victims in Broward, and people thought, wow, that is incredible. And sadly, we've seen many since then, in Broward specifically. We have sex trafficking of minors in Miami, but typically we don't have as many victims in one case. We have continued to see a trend. We have continued to see that it's not just DCF kids that are, you know, in custody. We continue to see kids who come from homes, who are recruited at schools by other girls at schools, that we have definitely drugs being offered oftentimes, but not always, to the minors in order to get them to prostitute so that the traffickers can gain. We now, today, have in Miami a case involving a minor who, or actually two minors who were prostituted by allegedly a DCF employee down in the Keys who was working with someone in Miami. These are the types of things that we see. So what can we, all do? You know, I saw the movie Selma, and I was really moved by it. I think it's great that it came out this month. A couple of things struck me. One was that it was horrible, all of the things that happened to people who were trying to march to support voting rights for blacks. And it was the awareness of the fact that it was publicized that really led to the support of so many Americans that led to significant change. And I think that human trafficking is the same in the sense that it is a hidden crime often, and that community awareness and the ability to prevent and to change and to improve and rescue victims starts with everyone coming together and seeing and understanding what this is, which is why it's so important that you're here today and why I come on a Saturday afternoon for you, because I appreciate that you understand that. And then the second thing about the movie was that it really hit home that that particular movement was so about people. And perhaps the most important thing that I've learned in working on human trafficking is that behind every crime and statute and thing that we talk about is a real person. And that the only way that we can make change is through collaborative effort. And that's why I want to say that I was so impressed that Kamala actually asked for and prepared a sheet for people on things that they can do. Because oftentimes people like to talk about it, they like to hear about it, but, you know, that's kind of as far as it goes. So thank you for everything. Know that there's a lot more to know, and there are a lot of the cases we don't publicize until after they're completed, because we really value the victim's privacy. But no, this is a problem for us, a big problem. So thank you for being here.
Out of the day to join us today. My name is Detective Lorraine Chapanik, and this is my partner, Detective Nicholas Masters. And we work for the Broward Sheriff's Office in a special unit that deals specifically with human trafficking and internet crimes against children. what, just a little bit about how we get the cases and what we do with them when we get them is not only do we deal with what comes in from our deputies out on the street, which could be because they came in contact with a prostitute or a call or what have you, but we also deal with tips that come in through our cyber tip line or through NCMEC. I don't know if anybody has, or if there isn't anybody here from NCMEC, which is the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. And they get tips that come in anonymously and they are filtered through, we have, how many towns?
62 counties.
62 counties, we have a task force that we either determine where it needs to go and we'll send that tip, or if it's most of them, Broward County, myself and Nick take care of that. And usually it's because somebody's reported that they believe a child is being sexually exploited, and they might be advertising on some of our internet sites for sex, through an escort service, or usually there's a pimp involved, and they're posting their ad online for sex, and people call. You know, it's like shopping on Craigslist. That's one of the sites. You know, there is a section for escorts, and there is, you know, and they break it down, whether you want male, female, transgender, it doesn't make, I mean, there's something for everybody out there. So we deal with that, and hopefully, you know, in our arrest, we love Barbara and her office. We try to take our cases to their office because of the federal system is so much swifter, and the penalties are better. Not that we don't take them on state, but we like to go federal on that. And this is one of the fastest growing industries around right now. Our criminals, our targets, our pimps have figured out, and they figured out very, very quickly how profitable it is for them. And most of them, you know, they used to be our dope slingers. They used to be the guys on the corner selling their, you know, bags of weed and what have you, and then they realized, I could only sell one bag of weed one time. I could sell this girl over and over and over and over again. And it's an enterprise. So they figured it out. It's where the money is. And it's competition. Definitely it's competition. We did last year, we covered how many?
We recovered just from Broward.
Just from Broward, 15 juveniles. We deal mostly with the juveniles. Not to say that, you know, we don't have the adults that we go out and rescue, because they are victims. We are rescuing them. We focus mostly on the juveniles. We did how many operations? Six operations in Broward, three in Dade County, where we have detectives, which we figured out this is usually our John that calls for a date with a girl. So this is why he's not, no pictures. We take a picture of him. We usually set up in a hotel somewhere and we call. If any of you have ever seen it on Dateline NBC, they do a really, really good job. In fact, we were just in Polk County a few weeks ago, and Dateline was there. We were observing the way they do their operations, see if there's any way that we could tweak ours. They run very smoothly. And usually we end up with the last one that we did, we ended up with 27 arrests. And a couple of them were travelers, where we had some of our internet crimes against children's detectives there chatting online, trying to get guys to travel to come to meet a underage child. And yeah, they'll travel. They will travel from far distances to come. So it's out there, and it is right in your own backyard. Unfortunately, I've been in law enforcement for over 25 years, and probably within the last 8 years is when we accidentally fell into something that turned out to be a 12-year-old victim that we rescued, but we had no idea what we were even getting into. And here we are 8 years later on a task force and we are the only two that do it for BSO in Broward. Now, there are task force members, like from different agencies. We work with the FBI, HSI, FDLE, Fort Lauderdale, Cross Springs. However, within our agency, Nick and I are the ones that handle it, and it is extremely overwhelming. And there is a lot of work, and it's unfortunate that there are these victims out there. Most of you have children, are young adults. I am telling you, be the nosiest parent, aunt, father, cousin, sister, brother. I don't care. Be nosy. Be vigilant. Be in your kids' stuff. Monitor their social media. Block some of their social media and find out where they're going, who they're talking to, who they're chatting with, who their friends are, because these girls are being recruited at school. They are being recruited at the mall. They are being recruited any place that you think that they that you're going to meet somebody. It's crazy. And I'm telling you, I'm not saying that if a parent had been more in their child's life or more nosy than they weren't, that would have stopped the child or it would have helped the child. But I'm telling you, it definitely helped. When we pull phones from these girls, a lot of it is done, you know, on their cell phones, on their laptops, on their whatever device that they have. So please be nosy and be vigilant.
One thing before we leave you, we interviewed a pimp not too long ago, and the quote that he gave us really sums it all up. He told us that he doesn't have to control the girl physically. Everyone has this image in their mind that there's a girl somewhere or a guy chained to a bed in some dark alley, in some dark bedroom, this and that. He told us, I don't have to chain her to a bed. I'll put chains on her mind. I control her mind. I control her body. And it doesn't get any more sense. That was words straight from a pimp that we heard. And it doesn't ring any truth with that. He doesn't have to restrain her. As long as he controls her mind some way, manipulates her, finds her vulnerability, he can control what she does and how she does it.
It is amazing because these girls will not flip on them at all. They think that they're coming, they're there for them 24/7, they're going to rescue them, they're going to take care of them. They will not flip. That's how controlling they are. So again, I went over. I'm sorry. However, if anything else, be nosy, make sure you know what your children are doing, and if you see or you suspect that there is something going on and you're not sure what it is, call your local law enforcement. Let somebody come out. Let us, you know, try to evaluate and let us get some help if that's what's needed.
Before you go, if I can just add, I know in the handouts there's a 1-800 number for the Polaris Project, and the hotline. That hotline number does eventually get routed to BSO as well as to other law enforcement officers. I recommend that when you're not really sure what you've got, you know, some people, I mean, you're not going to call 911 if something is suspicious and you're not feeling like you can call the police department right away, but that's a good way to send things. It does make its way, and in fact, my office is copied on those, and so we review those as well. So please pay attention to the Polaris Project number that you put in the materials.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. Before I bring out the organizations that serve the victims, I want to recognize another commissioner of City of Weston who is here, Tom Coleman. Thank you very much for coming.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am Sally Barenzweig. I am one of the co-founders of KidSafe Foundation. And I feel very privileged and honored to be in the company of all of these great people who are doing amazing work and reacting to what is a horrible, horrible crime. We're a little different. We are the prevention side. Our mission is to provide education to children and adults to prevent child sexual abuse, bullying, and internet dangers. Child sex trafficking is child abuse. So our philosophy is that every child deserves the right to be safe, to have a voice, to know how to access help, and every adult needs to be educated to be the first line of defense in a child's safety. One out of four girls and one out of six boys will be sexually exploited before the age of 18. 90% of the time they are harmed by someone they know, and 68% of the time they are harmed by a family member. 30 to 50% of sex offenders are juveniles at the average age of 14. However, as horrible as these statistics are, most children never, ever report. Child sex trafficking, 70 to 90% of children who are trafficked have been sexually abused. So it is very, very important that we prevent them from being abused, because they will run away. And when they run away, one out of three middle school children who run away will be approached by a sex trafficker. So what makes a child vulnerable? As a lot of the other speakers talked about, every single child is vulnerable to child sexual abuse and to sex trafficking. However, children who have no personal safety education, children who are loners, who lack confidence, who lack self-esteem, who are told by adults, you must always obey an adult, who are never taught about secrets, are more vulnerable to child sexual abuse. In our program, we do everything we can to empower children that they have the right to be safe. They have the right to say no to anybody that makes them feel confused, uncomfortable, or unsafe. Our approach is that we do a three-tier approach. We start our program, which is an eight-week curriculum that myself and Cherie, we're both mental health therapists, child safety experts. We have a lot of information behind us that backed us in writing this curriculum. But anyway, it's an eight-week curriculum where we actually go into preschools and elementary schools in Palm Beach, Broward, and a few in Miami, where we teach through an eight-week course the kids, and we're teaching them refusal skills. We do parent seminars, we do teacher workshops, and we will train anybody working with children in sexual abuse prevention. So we do this starting at the age of four. So the average age that a child is sex trafficked is 11 or 12. We're getting in early. We're trying to prevent this from happening. So KidSafe has served over 40 schools just this year, preschools and elementary schools, over 40 childcare organizations. This year we will have taught over 4,000 children, and over 5,000 adults will have had our training. Since our inception, which we've been doing this for about 10 years, we've taught over 40,000 children and have brought our trainings to 15,000 adults. It's not enough. Child sex trafficking is abuse. So I want to tell you a little bit about our kids program, because we teach kids through fun, not fear, okay? When I say to you, stop, drop, and roll, what am I talking about?
Fire safety,
right? And our kids know those words. They know how to role play what happens if there's a real fire, because they have prevention education in school and they have to practice it every single month. The bell rings, the kids get up, it's muscle memory, they know exactly what to do. That's exactly what we do. The kids never know that we're talking about child sexual abuse. They never know we're talking about bullying or internet dangers. We're role-playing real-life situations and giving them the chance to have a voice, know how to access help, and to, we do it through role-play, we do it through art. With the younger kids, we do it through song, and we do it through two children's books that we co-authored. We won awards for both of them, and we're very proud to tell you that they are coming out this year in Spanish and Creole. We teach a language of safety the same way stop, drop, and roll. We teach kids a language of safety. We teach parents a language of safety. We teach the teachers a language of safety. Because we feel if everybody is on the same page using the same language of safety, our children are going to be safer. In our adult seminars, we are teaching adults about the epidemic of child sexual abuse, what makes children vulnerable. We want to show them what are the emotional, physical, and behavioral signs of a child who is actually in need, and it's not always child sexual abuse. We're talking to them about adolescent sex offenders. We are actually taking them through what a grooming process actually looks like, so they can be watchful of their father, mother, sister, brother, neighbor, coach, and what they're doing. We will talk to teachers and other people who are in charge of adults about green light behaviors, yellow light behaviors, red light behaviors of themselves, what they are doing, what they may be doing to cross a line, to cross a boundary. And then disclosure. God forbid a child does disclose, what do you do? And then to me, one of the most important things is the reporting of child sexual abuse. I have taught teachers who have been in the system for 30 to 40 years, and I'm a teacher, so it's nothing against teachers, who are so uncomfortable about reporting abuse. They think they have to go to a guidance counselor. They think they have to go to the principal, and time goes by, and that child continues to be abused. So we really need to educate not just professional mandated reporters, but everybody sitting in this room is a mandated reporter, and you need to report. You are not an investigator. We leave that to the professionals. You have a suspicion of abuse, you report abuse. We do a lot of research in our program, and this was just from one from a foster care agency. We did a big training with foster care with using ChildNet, and their knowledge about child sexual abuse before and after our training, which we're very proud. Again, you guys talked about this and know it much more, but we feel you can't look the other way. Once you know better, the hope is that you do better, and that is our hope with KidSafe. The most important statistic to me today is that 95% of abuse and exploitation of children is preventable with education. Isn't that astounding? That we can actually prevent this from happening? And that is our mission, that is our goal with KidSafe, and that's why we're here today to be part of this, because if we can stop children from being abused, we can help make a dent in child sex trafficking. So thank you so much. I'm not even taking all of my time. You can connect with us all of these ways, every kind of social media. We have a table out front. And, you know, I have to, we are a nonprofit. I have to show our, but we will have a gala that we would love anybody to attend. So thank you so much.
I'm the Director of Social Services at the Salvation Army. The Salvation Army has different programs for victims of human trafficking across the U.S. However, here in Broward County, we don't specifically have programs for human trafficking. But we deal with homeless people every day. And you cannot have homeless people that you will not find the victims of human trafficking. As you know, the experts have described, human trafficking victims are not just people who are uneducated, poor, from poor families or anything like that. People who are victims are also educated women. They are educated men. So just imagine the homeless population, how vulnerable they are. If they have to look every day what they are going to eat, where they're going to sleep, where they're going to use the bathroom, you know, just imagine the opportunities that the victims have. We have programs that work with individuals, men and women who are adults. You know, they became homeless and they come to us and we help them out. We also work with families. And families with children. Last year we worked with four victims of human trafficking. And you might say only four, we have so many in Broward County, you're absolutely right. But I think we do such wonderful work with the children, and I think we should continue with that. But a lot of times we leave our adults a little bit to the side, because a lot of times we blame the victims. When sometimes law enforcement goes and finds somebody who is involved in human trafficking, they actually arrest the victim, right? And sometimes they don't concentrate on the pimp. And what happens is, these women a lot of times don't see themselves as victims. You know, and that's where we see our work being a little more difficult, because as much as we want to help them, they don't see themselves as being victims. You know, one of the most frustrating parts for us is when we are helping them, they're with us, we're going through the program, they want to go back to their pimps. Mm-hmm. And they want to say, why would they do that? Don't they see, you know, now they're free, they can go on their own, they can, you know, start their life. It's not that easy. Because just like the detective said, you know, they are not something, you're not going to see the bonds that is going to bond them with their abuser, with their pimp. Everything is in their heads. Not only that, but these women, they have done this for so long sometimes that, you know, they forgot that they have other abilities, that they have other things that they can do, that they can actually go to school, that they can actually get a degree, that they can actually finish high school. So they don't see themselves as doing anything else than what they were doing before. And that's very sad. That makes makes our work very difficult. We at the Salvation Army only deal with victims that who are adults. We don't deal with children. We leave that for other organizations because we don't have the infrastructure. We would love to expand, but not now. You know, we're still learning a lot about, you know, how to work with the victims. And we do it in a very discreet way. We don't, you are probably one of the few organizations that are going to know that we do deal with victims of human trafficking. We don't advertise it, not here in Broward County. But like I said, we have different cities where we actually have full-blown programs for human trafficking. We have came up with a manual on how to work with human with victims of human trafficking. And we have gone and did presentations to other organizations where they were going to start the program themselves. I'm very happy to be here this afternoon. I would love if you have any kind of questions to ask me at this time. You know, I think I do better with that. How do you maybe say, well, where do you put these things? You know, how do you get them? Where do you get them from? We usually get a phone call from a detective. They will say, hey, you know, I just got this this person and I'm looking for somewhere to put them. Do you have space? And we always make space for them. We always make space for them. No matter what is happening, we always make sure that they can come to our facilities. We have trained professionals that are specifically trained to deal with victims of human trafficking. As I have said, that our primary focus is homelessness. And when you work with homeless people, it's not necessarily the same skills that you're going to use to work with someone who is a victim of human trafficking. It's totally different. So we have case managers who are specifically trained to deal with these victims, and we put them in specific rooms. We don't put them in with everybody else. It's totally different. So we are very proud of the work that we do with victims of human trafficking, and we're always open to anybody who can, you know, give us a call and say, this is what's going on in my neighborhood, this is what I see. A lot of the times, we don't pay attention to what's going on around us. And I think one of the most important things that we can do to help stop human trafficking is really pay attention. Pay attention. If you're sitting at a restaurant, the other day I was somewhere, I don't want to say where, and this person was, I was actually doing my nails, I want to say that, I'm not saying where, okay? So this lady was talking to me, and she was just, you know, which me, I like to talk a lot. So I started kind of asking her questions, you know, where you're from, and how long have you been working here, how long has this place been open, and she started kind of telling me, you know, well, you know, this place has been open for 5 years, I've been working here for 2 years, and then suddenly I hear this guy who was sitting at a cash register. He told her something in a different language that I didn't understand. So as soon as he said something, she just went back to doing her work, and that was the end of the conversation. So these kind of things happen. So you have to pay attention. If you're in a restaurant, you know, who is doing what? Are they looking at you? I mean, it's just educating yourself and looking at those signs and not being afraid to call. I'm a social worker, so I'm a mandated reporter. Like, you know, when I tell my people, I train them about child abuse and reporting. So you don't have to investigate. That's not your job. All you have to do is you're acting in good faith. You're protecting. You're trying to protect the child. You make that phone call. Let the professionals who are trained to do the investigation and find if it's true or not, let them do their work. This is what we do. So I thank you for having me this afternoon, and thank you for being here.
I'd like to thank you for allowing women in distress to share a little bit. We basically deal with domestic violence, and that we are the certified domestic violence center in Broward County. You would say, well, how does that affect human trafficking? Now, my team and I sat together this week to kind of discuss that, so I make this presentation and make a real good understanding. And we looked at, and we kind of intercepted some of the areas where victims of domestic violence and victims of human trafficking and how it interrelates. And one thing that we do as an agency is about empowerment. And empowerment is one of the tools that we can use to help these people get out of these situations. But the one thing we really looked at a lot and began to realize is that when we look at some of the victims of domestic violence, domestic violence is really a little bit more about intimate partner violence. And this is this thing where people are in a partnership relationship. And that relationship is something that people say, well, why did this person not leave? Why did this person not go? There's numerous reasons that fear, economics, it's really about power and control. And so when we had this dialogue about how are these two things related, and I think the officer said it best, the detective said it best, is that when you get in an intimate partner relationship, that person loses their self for that person. So that person now has control to make them do anything. They can tell them, listen, I want you to go out and sell yourself. Matter of fact, I want you to take all your children and go sell yourself. And they're not thinking in nope at this point that, oh, this is something wrong. This is something I'm doing as a part of my relationship. Now, it's a hard thing for us to sometimes understand. But there are many reasons why this happened, because it's a learned behavior. These people have been exposed to some trauma. And they believe that this is a way to continue and have someone who cares about them. Because no abuser or trafficker comes up to the person and slaps them or puts a gun on them and tells them to come. No, it's very customary. It's like, I'm going to be the person that's there for you. I'm going to take care of you. I want to give you everything that you have not had. And once they have them hooked, they can get them to do whatever they want. It's one of those things, and no one can come between it. When we go out and speak to people, one of the major things that occur is people say, how can we get my daughter, how can we get our son to get out of this relationship? We would even kidnap them and try to take them somewhere away from this abuser. And the issue is that they are now so involved and interrelated into this relationship that it's nothing that you can do. All you can do is try to educate them to get out. So, because sometimes even if you were to kidnap them and take them away somewhere, as soon as they get to a telephone or get to something, they're going to call that person to come and pick them up. And we're scratching our heads, and the families are frustrated, and they become so. And we look at that, and we know that then it becomes this thing of where victim blaming comes into play. And we're very concerned about that, because we want to understand that these people are involved in intimate partner violence. This intimate partner violence has them in a weakened way that they feel that these are the only people that care about them, the only people that are doing it. And we have to, sometimes as people who are frustrated and dealing with it, we kind of push them away. And what we try to really talk about and ask people to do is, when we think about domestic violence, we preach a lot about that domestic violence is always seen as physical. And I try to explain to people that domestic violence is on a spectrum. Spectrum on one end, where police are usually only involved, or how only you find out reports are, through physical attacks. We have one of threats. Threats are probably one of the most easiest ways that abusers or traffickers control their victims. And then we have the other end, the social verbal abuse. And that's where they tear them down so then they can threaten to control. So when we understand that, not to just look at the physical, because the person may have never been hit. This is almost identical to what we deal with when we're looking at domestic violence cases and we're dealing with our victims. So some things I wanted to share today about what we can do, or things we need to start looking at when we're dealing with this, is recognizing that we have a power and control in our community to take some steps to stop this. And it's up to us. Sometimes I preach this a lot about domestic violence, where people say, well, that's really somebody else's problem, that, you know, that's their personal problem. But as little as a issue of domestic violence can become human trafficking, just that easy, that we don't understand. So holding abusers accountable is probably the most important. Let them know that that's not gonna be accepted in our community. This is not something that we want to occur in our community. I think that video said it very clear. Empowering others to do the same. Not me only being the person with the sign, but going to gather other people to say, let's go and fight for this and save these people. And last, encourage when you find victims, encourage them to talk and give them the resources and support them. They may push you away. They may say, I don't want your help, but you have to. And I tell people all the time when we're working with these difficult clients who don't want your help, you got to make it like if you're holding a lighter in a dark room and that you want them to see you. But if you hold the lighter too long, your hand starts to burn. And so what you have to do is just keep flickering it so you don't burn yourself. Because you have to be that patient, because there's going to become a time where they might wake up and say, I want to look for a light, and they need to see a flicker, they need to see something, so we can be there to try to bring them in. some of the things we need to do is be mindful of the red flags. Red flags are what's there. Things you can look up. Look up what some of these red flags are, and you see them all the time. I think she gave a perfect description. I think that I'm an observer by nature as a therapist. I think of the same story. I was at in Orlando at a hotel, and I seen these two ladies there in the lobby, and it was with two guys that they didn't interact, but I know they was together. And I seen the ladies all in the walking around the hotel, and I just was. It was strange that they sat in one place and the guy sat there, and then soon one guy came in and said, for all of us to go, and they all left out. But the interaction wasn't like it was on a family trip, and I said, well, that's pretty strange that these two ladies are together. They're not interacting with those guys, but I know they're together. Well, why is that? And that's the kind of things that we kind of see that happens all the time. Understanding the barriers of justice, that a lot of times a lot of victims have a lot of barriers. They feel that maybe if I even come and tell somebody, I'll be arrested. Or I'll be deported, or these things will happen, or no one will even really care. To be able to recognize that it's sometimes difficult to seek assistance. And it doesn't seem like it's, we're here to help, but sometimes it doesn't work out like that for them when they're looking through their eyes. And understand some of the reasons why they're willing to stay involved with this. If we can understand that, we can better help them. Because it's very difficult when we don't understand it. We're saying, I can't deal with this. If we understand why they're still there, and just understand how human trafficking affects the victims and our community as a whole. Sure, there are many questions and concerns. I don't know how much time I have, and I want to keep us on time. So when we get to the question part, any questions we have about how we service people, I'll be willing to answer those. Thank you very much.
Okay, so with that in mind, okay, here we go. All right, let me just say that this is a complex crime. There are should we just hang on a second? I'm hanging on to
Betty, Betty and Gallagher.
Oh, Betty and Gallagher from
Thank you so much. Thank you for taking that in the news. I appreciate you being here.
Sorry. No, Betty and from Debbie Wasserman Schultz has been in the forefront of this issue, and many, many thanks to her for everything that she's done over the past 8 years on this issue. So thank you. Now, this is a very complex issue, and it is international, it's domestic, it's here, it's over there, but it's in Broward. And you all took time out of your day to come here to maybe learn about it, maybe you know about it, and maybe you just wanted to come and lend your abilities and your social skills to helping. What I find is that we have the ability, just as people, to be cruel, number one, and we also have the ability to be compassionate. And then there's passion. And because you're here today, I'm assuming you have a real passion for this subject, and I appreciate it. I appreciate Barbara being here. I appreciate Ron, Nick. Okay, everybody that's here, Nick back there, hey, Nick. Everybody that's come today that has a real passion for this subject. The things that you can do, obviously, to get involved, I mean, it's all over the board. But yes, education and awareness are so important. Broward Human Trafficking came into existence about 7.5 years ago, and it is still a viable force in this county. Please understand, they do outreach where they do hotel-motel outreach, where they'll look for kids that are missing. You mentioned the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children. The Broward Human Trafficking Coalition works with the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children and tries to find kids who are runaways and missing. Again, the adults of this crime, don't forget them. It's so often that they say, well, they're complicit. They know what they were getting into. I gotta tell you, you know what? What are the three most powerful words in any language? I don't care what language. Three most powerful words.
I love you.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. So you are all paying attention. Those words, when somebody utters those words to you, you'll do just about anything for them. And you know what? People do. And when they're talking about people's backgrounds, we're not just talking about the children here, we're talking about the adults too. Okay? You hear those three words and you'll do just about anything. And I know it's hard for us to imagine sometimes the things that people will do. But we do them. We find ourselves getting into relationships with people and we do things, I never thought I'd go skydiving, But I did, because he said he loved me. As he pushed me out of the plane. I gotta tell you, this is a very, very serious topic. And does anybody know what tomorrow is? And none of you ringers are allowed to say. Does anybody know what tomorrow is? January 11th?
Trafficking.
National Human Trafficking Awareness Day. President Barack Obama has made tomorrow National Human Trafficking Awareness Day. And it is about freedom. It is about us being able to have the personal freedom and being able to help someone else. Now, I'm going to give you all a test. I know it's late in the day and it's a Saturday and you probably overworked all week, but that's okay. All right. You're going to get this number that I'm going to give to you because it's a very important number. When you see something, you know that campaign of you see something, say something? This is just like that.
888-3737-888.
888-3737-888. Yes! That is the Polaris Project National Human Trafficking tip line that you can call if you see something. All right? Say something. But don't just call and go, I just saw two guys in the lobby at a hotel. I'm going to use your example. With my two girls. I think they're being trafficked. They need a little bit more information. Just a little. Okay? Descriptions would be nice. Maybe the vehicle they got into. You know, how they were acting. What made you think this was a trafficking situation? And you know, everybody needs to be a Mrs. Kravitz. I would challenge you if you don't know who Mrs. Kravitz is. Half the room probably does, half the room probably doesn't. Okay? But if you don't know who Mrs. Kravitz is, you gotta know who your neighbors are. Who are your neighbors? I mean, we, and now we go running into our houses, and we go and we get in front of watching the TV or make dinner, and then we run back and we get into our cars and we go back to work and we do that all week, and then we come here on Saturday, which thank you. But, you know, I mean, we do this and we don't take time to know who our neighbors are. And what's going on? You know, 39 Filipinos were held against their will in Boca Raton in the gated community. Nobody saw it! 39 in a gated community! Alright? We had the Boom Boom Room operating in Oakland Park. That's what they were talking about with Broward Sheriff's Office that investigated that and they're still, finding victims from that. These were all examples of things that are happening in our neighborhoods. Keep an eye out. Watch. Just be vigilant, get to know. And also, kids, with the Kids Safe Program, that's wonderful. Because kids, you know, we all think with this, we think with this, some other people think with other things. We're not going there. But when you think with your gut, usually your gut will be the one that will steer you always the right direction. Always, always, always it'll take you in the right direction. Your head says, you know, no, I shouldn't go out with this person because, you know, maybe they're a little, you know, like Will and the Bunny, I don't think I want to get involved. You know, your heart's saying, no, they just like rabbits and, you know, hot pots. And your gut is going, run away. So what are you going to listen to, okay? But seriously, everybody, our experts today are here to answer questions. Barbara Martinez, I've known Barbara for a while, and she is fantastic. And I gotta say that we're really privileged to have her here today. And Kamala did a fantastic job in pulling this thing together. We have the Sheriff's Office that has been in this fight for a number of years. We've got NOVA Project HEAT, which is Health Educators Against Trafficking, in the room. We've got DHS ICE in the room, which, for those of you who don't know that acronym, it's Department of Homeland Security, ICE. We have Dr. Chico from Broward Health over in the room, and we've got other folks here that, you know, please, take Toby, please, Commissioner, and Commissioner, please take your time when we have the refreshments to mingle and get to know some folks and ask questions and that sort of thing. And I'm just here to wrap it up, but I do want to be able to have these folks present any answers to questions that you may have. And of course, we have the first one. Why am I not surprised? Yes.
The research about human trafficking, and read about people flying to Atlanta to have an affair with a charity bought on the internet and then go back. I was sharing it with a friend of mine. When she heard the story, she said, it must be a disease. It must be an addiction. It's a crime. I know it's a crime, but why do you think?
You know, I got some really good advice from people who work with victims of crimes because, you know, although I do,
that's not my expertise. My job is to do that, but mainly to focus on the prosecution. And they say repeatedly, always, don't try to put yourself in the position or the situation of a victim. And why? Because, like we've explained, every victim has a different vulnerability and different circumstances. And so you, in your life today, and me in my life today, are very, you know, have a different situation, and we're very blessed maybe not to have those vulnerabilities today. That doesn't mean, by the way, that it can't happen to me tomorrow, because I've seen things like drug addiction affect people's vulnerability, things like getting into a relationship with a bad seed has really impacted women significantly. And as for kids, I'll tell you, you bring up something that I think is very interesting. Following up on the whole media thing, kids today are really, social media is a way to recruit kids, especially, but also adults, but mainly kids, for trafficking, sex trafficking. And the interesting thing is, if you ask kids, you know, who is this person that you're communicating, your friend, they say yes. And they say yes because even though they've never met the person, they've built a relationship online. So we're asking, oh, do you know this person? Oh, yes, he's my friend. And they're like, oh, great, creepy guy in the background, right? So it's interesting. The social media has really changed that. So it doesn't, you know, by the time, by the way, kids actually get together with some of their traffickers, they probably have communicated online with them for a really long time. And he's probably communicating with, and I say he, usually traffickers are male, that he's probably been communicating with a lot of other victims at the same time. So remember that as well, you know.
You've described the perpetrators in ways that sound as if they went to school, that they had training, that they're all doing it a certain way.
They're smart.
Is that it?
Look at the drug dealers, drug traffickers, people traffickers. I mean, we're talking about commodity, the business brain. Who knows why they get into it? Has anybody noticed the proliferation of massage parlors throughout Broward County?
Yeah.
How many of you see the flashing neon lights and are drawn to those flashing neon lights at like 10 o'clock at night to go get a massage? Does anybody know what a table shower is? Don't answer that. Okay. You know, they're smart. They know how to make a buck. They know how to flip the buck. They know how to turn this over. Like I said, this is a multi-dimensional, very complex crime, but it boils down to something very simple, which is just exploitation of people. And like Barbara is saying, like everybody said here, it's about the vulnerabilities of that person.
And if I can add to that, let me say, I mean, and I know that Vic can tell you, there is a lot of publications where people can learn how to traffic, you know, right? If you're a street type of pimp, absolutely, he can recite to you all of the different, you know, and we've introduced them as evidence, publications that are out there that they promote. So that's one. Two, you know, I used to work fraud cases, and it's interesting. Fraud cases are similar in this way. There's a scheme, and people figure out how to do the scheme, and then they keep doing it. Medicare fraud. This type of a durable medical equipment type of fraud, and then they change it to something else. They teach each other how to do it. And as somebody was just telling me, social media. They all hang out. Now they're getting to know each other on social media. And they say, great, you're a pimp or a trafficker too, depending on what type of scheme. So there is, just like in any other crime, they do tend to gravitate towards others who can teach them, and they find ways that they can perfect their business.
And can law enforcement go after that kind of source?
As far as the social media side?
Well, the print publications, the I'm not saying censor them or anything, but I'm trying to say is, if you know where they are, then can you gather around there and...
It's definitely something that we try and monitor it. And I say monitor just for the simple fact that if we stop it, they're going to find some other way. So if at least we know where they are, we can have a better idea of what's going on. If we try and put a stop to it immediately, especially I heard some people whispering about free speech,
yep,
censorship and things like that, it does fall under that as well. But we also need to have, if people, we, if we're not getting thousands of calls from tipsters every day, we need to find, we need to somewhere where we can go to look as well, instead of just popping in at the hotels and things like that. But to jump off of what Adrian and Barbara said, they're master manipulators. They're going to find what somebody is missing, whether it's an adult or a juvenile, it's a place to stay. It's, my parents won't give me a cell phone, they don't give me internet access, I can't do this after 10 o'clock, I can't do that. They're going to come in and the pimps and the traffickers are going to fill that void, whatever it might be. I don't have a dad at home, I don't have a mom at home. They're going to put themselves in right into that void, and that's how they recruit.
Can I say something about child abusers in general? That most child abusers are heterosexual, well-educated, married with children, and seemingly upstanding citizens in the community. And that's why you're always seeing the headlines. They were the coach of the year. They were this. I mean, that their whole goal is to manipulate children and adults.
So, she raises a very good point, which is there is no master mold of this as far as, you know, but when you look at the demand side of it, that's one side that's just, you know, we do have to go and we have to be kind of nosy. And go, who are these people that are going into the massage establishments at lunchtime? Not that they may not be a legitimate massage establishment, it could be, but who's going in there at lunchtime staying 15, 20 minutes? Watch the cars. You wonder why some of these service providers are late to your house? No, but anyway, you see the trucks going in. I mean, seriously, be nosy. Be nosy. Did you ever go into one of those parlors from massage places and ask if they take insurance? Okay? Just saying. Okay? And also, you know, when you see the kid that's a little bit out of place, or the kid that's having a hard time in school, or the kid that's hanging out, you know, we did a Broward Human Trafficking did a training for 1,500 bus drivers in Broward County. Do you know that sometimes they're the first responsible adult and the last responsible adult the kids see in a given day? And boy, did they give BHTC an education. Because they were able to say, the kids get on the bus, the kids change in the bus, get off the bus, go out. And, you know, these are kids that come from all walks of life now, okay? So, you know, while everyone here has touched on so many important points about this crime, please understand that it is very complex, and you have with you some really good information. But I'm going to ask you one more time for that number because I like to hear it.
888-877-888.
Yes! Oh, thank you very much. I know the food is starting to smell really good here. Sorry, I think there was another question from a gentleman who I'm going to direct to Barbara because.
Well, okay, last year, Adrian and I had a little difference of opinion as it pertained to prostitution. And I said that not all prostitution is exploitation or coercion.
Now, to some extent I agreed. Give me a little credit there. But then we went beyond that.
All right. But to recently add to some of the things was our former governor of New York State and his paramour. She was not forced into doing it. She had a purpose behind it, and it was to make money.
Now you're changing your question a little bit. You were talking about legal prostitution.
She's a businesswoman.
And also,
there was some recent, whether it was Discovery or the Learning Channel, there are many female students who are prostituting themselves in order to pay for their college educations because they find it much easier.
First of all, let me just say shame, because we should not have a situation where people feel that they have to prostitute themselves in order to pay for a college education.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. But the reality remains, this is the only way they can walk out of college without a major debt.
I'm going to give this to Paul Rogers. You know. Come on.
There's a lot of difference of opinion, obviously, about the prostitution issue. And I work for the federal government. I can't speak for the federal government on that. And I'm not even going to give you my assessment. I can tell you this. There are laws that, you know, make it a crime
to commit human trafficking, sex trafficking, and then there is a separate crime called prostitution. And absolutely for us, there is a line there, and we do not, not all prostitution cases rise to the level, especially from a legal standpoint, right, of sex trafficking. The thing that I train State Department officials and law enforcement officers who travel a lot overseas. And one of the interesting things that always comes up, right, is that Johns, people who pay for these services, especially, for example, in some place where they're there for a night or so, how the hell do they know whether this person's being forced to do this or not? And I ask that question, right? And it's interesting because I didn't pose it to them actually first. I had an agent who travels all over the world, and hopefully he doesn't do this himself, but he was saying, you know, interesting, there's a lot of people who tourists who travel and engage in prostitution. And the interesting thing is they don't ever think about who this person is. They're not thinking about that. They're not looking at it. Maybe if our investigators looked at this particular brothel, it would turn out that there is a trafficking scenario. So I throw that out there. You know, if we're working the case, we're going to get to the bottom of it. We're going to determine where the line is. But if you're somebody who's paying for sex, are you doing the same thing? Maybe, maybe not. So,
yeah. Okay, and on that note,
thank you.
Until next year. Hold on. Do we have time for one more question? Does anybody have a question? Yes, ma'am.
You guys said that it was mostly males doing the recruiting and recruiting groups, but do you guys see that there are some females doing the recruitment?
There are girls in schools, absolutely. Girls, the bottom book. Oh, okay, yeah, let me not swear. There's terminology for the individuals. However, yes, women, girls, families, interfamilial pimping, mothers, aunts, I think we covered it all, but yeah, it's not just men, it's not just boys, it's not just the Romeo pimps, it's not the pimp culture, it's not the pimp and hoe culture, it's the best friend who's, you know, or the brother who's pimping out the sister. It's across the board, and as far as your mind can go, it's like the Twilight Zone, okay? As far as your mind can go, that's what's happening out there. I mean, I've done trainings where I've told people when you go into a house for DCF and people that do and CFIS, they go in there, I said, well, if you see dog holes in the house and there's no evidence of dogs, what is that telling you? Is that telling you something, maybe? If there's no evidence of any dogs in the house and there's evidence that somebody is living in a garage where there's a mattress pushed up against a wall and dog holes there? But anyway, this is, you know, I know. We can go on forever, and I'm going to let Barbara have the last word.
I was just going to say that in some countries, like, you know, for example, in Asia, a lot of the targets are females, and they're just as abusive, if not more abusive, than males. So it depends, and it is all types, and we are seeing with the minors definitely an increased trend in female traffickers and recruiters. But interestingly, at least in the U.S., the cases that I've seen, the men still profit the most.
So, Commissioner, I have to let the Commissioner.
Okay, it's not a question, it's just a statement that human trafficking is not only for women, that young boys as well.
Oh, absolutely.
As well, and that we always seem to forget that. I know we're talking about women and everything, and I think we really have to remember that there are young boys and teenagers that are also involved in human trafficking, and we need to address that as well.
Thank you.
That's a good point, Toby, that the AAUW, you know, is focused on women.
Women and girls.
But good point.
I want to just go back to this question real quick and support Barbara on this. Vic Williams with Homeland Security Investigation. So I do presentations all the time. And I usually end my presentations by telling the crowd this. You know, there are a billion problems in the world. And if everybody just picked one and just addressed it and made, you know, yourself aware and share it, human trafficking just happened to be mine. And so to get deeper into your question, I don't worry about prostitution. Like you said, prostitution is illegal. Trafficking is legal. As long as I see the words force, fraud, and coercion, that's where I'm focused. So I don't get confused with, you know, the other issues. Those are my issues, force, fraud, and coercion.
Or minors.
So, well, I think, you know, minors. Just a statement-wise, I think the key word that everybody, you brought up,
continually in trafficking is it's exploitation. If somebody is paying their way through college, they're getting the money, not somebody who's exploiting them and taking the money.
Right.
So the key word is exploitation. But not how what money you're earning, but yes, exploitation.
Absolutely. Exploitation and vulnerability.
Exploitation is not one of the elements of a crime.
We can debate and debate and we can talk, and truly there is so much information that we could actually make this an 8-hour training. We have. We made this a 40-hour training. So please, there are so many resources here available to you. There's information and the tables outside. I'm going to turn this over to Pamela because she organized the entire event, and we thank her so much for allowing us to be here.
And I really, really want to thank the speakers. Each one of you gave us so much information, opened our eyes to things we probably should have seen but didn't see, you know. I really appreciate you taking the time to be with us, each one of you. And Adrian, thanks for lighting it up at the very end. You should. And I want to thank all of you for coming. We do have, courtesy Carolina Ale House, some refreshments for you that you could enjoy. But meet and talk with the speakers and the exhibitors. They have some information there that you could share. So happy Saturday evening. Enjoy the rest of the day.